thankful to have been born in this amazing country where the freedom to worship God in spirit and in truth is permitted and never challenged. Amen?
Amen.
And we live in a generation now, and the generations that are coming up, that do not understand the spiritual heritage that they've been given. And I believe it's our responsibility as the church, my responsibility as a proclaimer of truth, to make sure they understand the incredible blessing that they have been handed.
Amen.
July the 4th, 1776, a group of men on behalf of a nation, humbled before the Lord, decided to take a stand not on political principle, but on biblical principle.
Amen.
And it's a little bit lengthy. Probably a significant portion of us here today have never heard it, but I would like to read for you this morning the Declaration of Independence. Hear the words and imagine the heart behind these incredible men of faith. Don't you buy into this lie that they were a bunch of deists and they didn't serve God, they didn't believe in God, and if they did believe in God, they didn't think he was actively involved in anything. That's a lie straight from the pits of hell.
Amen.
These were men of great faith. These were men who started their sessions with hours of prayer. Not a token prayer. Hours of brokenness on their knees before the Lord, acknowledging that they were completely dependent upon Almighty God for any wisdom in the direction of our nation. And after weeks of broken prayer before the Lord, they came to this agreement. When in the course of human events it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitles them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed, that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Prudence, indeed, will dictate the governments long established should not be changed for light and transient causes. And accordingly, all experience has shown that mankind are more disposed to suffer while evils are sufferable than to right themselves by abolishing the forms to which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations pursuing invariably the same object evinces a design to reduce them under absolute despotism, it is their right, it is their duty to throw off such government and to provide new guards for their future security. Such has been the patient sufferance of these colonies, and such is now the necessity which constrains them to alter their former systems of government. The history of the King of Great Britain is a history of repeated injuries and usurpations, all having a direct object, the establishment of an absolute tyranny over these states. To prove this, let facts be submitted to a candid world. He has refused his assent to laws, the most wholesome and necessary for the public of good. He has forbidden his governors to pass laws of immediate and pressing importance unless suspended to their operation till his assent should be obtained. And when so suspended, he has utterly neglected to attend to them. He has refused to pass their law, other laws, for the accommodations of large districts of people, unless those people would relinquish the right of representation in the legislature, a right inestimable to them and formerly to tyrants only. He has called together legislative bodies in places unusual, uncomfortable, and distant from the depository of their public records for the sole purpose of fatiguing them into compliance with his measures. He has dissolved representative houses repeatedly for opposing with manly firmness his invasion of the rights of the people. He has refused for a long time after such dissolutions to cause others to be elected, whereby the legislative powers incapable of annihilation have returned to the people at large for their exercise. The state remaining in the meantime exposed to all dangers of invasion from without and convulsions within. He has endeavored to prevent the population of these states for that purpose obstructing the laws for naturalization of foreigners, refusing to pass others to encourage their migrations hither and raising conditions of new appropriations of land. He has obstructed the administration of justice by refusing his assent to laws for establishing judiciary powers. He's made judges dependent on his will, along for the tenure of their offices and the amount and payment of their salaries. He has erected a multitude of new officers and sent hither swarms of officers to harass our people and eat out their substance. He has kept among us, in times of peace, standing armies without the consent of our legislature. He has affected to render the military independent of and superior to the civil power. He has combined with others to subject us to a jurisdiction foreign to our Constitution and unacknowledged by our laws, giving his assent to their acts of pretend legislation, for quartering large bodies of armed troops among us, for protecting them by a mock trial from punishment for any murders which they should commit on the inhabitants of these states, for cutting off our trade with all parts of the world, for imposing taxes on us without our consent, for depriving us in many cases of the benefit of trial by jury, for transporting us beyond seas to be tried for pretended offices, for abolishing the free system of English laws in a neighboring province, establishing therein an arbitrary government, and enlarging its boundaries so as to render it at once an example and fit instrument for introducing the same absolute rule into these colonies, for taking away our charters, abolishing our most valuable laws, and altering fundamentally the forms of our governments, for suspecting our own legislatures and declaring themselves invested with power to legislate for us in all cases whatsoever. He has abdicated government here by declaring us out of his protection and waging war against us. He's plundered our seas, ravaged our coasts, burn our towns, and destroy the lives of our people. He is at this time transporting large armies of foreign mercenaries to complete the works of death, dissolution, and tyranny, already begun with circumstances of cruelty and perfidy, scarcely parallel in the most barbarous ages, totally unworthy the head of a civilized nation. He has constrained our fellow citizens, taken captive on the high seas, to bear arms against their country, to become the executioners of their friends and brethren, or to fall themselves by their hands. He's excited domestic insurrection among us and has endeavored to bring on the inhabitants of our frontiers, the merciless Indian savages who know rule of warfare is an undistinguished destruction of all ages, sexes, and conditions. In every stage of these oppressions, we have petitioned for redress in the most humble terms. Our repeated petitions have been answered only by repeated injury. A prince whose character is thus marked by every act which may define a tyrant is unfit to be the ruler of a free people. Nor have we been waiting, wanting in attentions to our British brethren. We have warned them from time to time of attempts by our legislature to extend an unwarrantable jurisdiction over us. We have reminded them of the circumstances of our immigration and settlement here. We have appealed to their native justice and magnanimity. And we have conjured them by the ties of our common kindred to disavow these usurpations, which would inevitably interrupt our connections and correspondence. They too have been deaf to the voice of justice and consanguinity. We must therefore acquiesce in the necessity which denounces our separation and hold them, as we hold the rest of mankind enemies of war, in peace, friends. We therefore, the representatives of the United States of America, in General Congress assembled, appealing to the Supreme Judge of the world for the recessitude of our intentions, do in the name and by the authority of the good people of these colonies, solemnly publish and declare that these United Colonies are, and of right ought to be, free and independent states, that they are absolved from all allegiance to the British Crown, and that all political connection between them and the state of Great Britain is now and ought to be totally dissolved, and that as free independent states, they have the full power to levy war, conclude peace, contract alliances, establish commerce, and to do all other acts and things which independent states may of right do. And for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor.
Amen.
I know there's a lot of stuff in there that's verbiage that we're not used to using today. Let me give you a quick summary of what you just heard. When the kingdoms and the governments of this world believe they have the authority to usurpate, to overcome, to overthrow, to ignore the rights of free people from the rights that were granted to them by their Creator God, we not only have the right but the responsibility to overthrow and replace that government. They believed it was their godly duty to stand up for the liberty and the freedom of the people that lived in these colonies. That God expected them to put everything on the line for freedom. And we as a nation now, if you go through the list of things there that were included with the oppression, with the usurpation of justice, where people were being imprisoned without a proper due process, where the government was imposing taxes without the consent of the people, and all the things that were listed there, all the oppressions that led us to revolution, I'm sad to tell you now that the government that we call the United States of the government, or the government of the United States, is more aggressive today than King George was in 1776. And I know that's not a pleasant thing to hear. I know it's not a worshipful thing to talk about. But I believe it is the God-given responsibility of Christians. And I'm laying it specifically on Christians. I believe Christians have a responsibility to declare the truth of God's word and the freedoms that are given to us through Christ Jesus alone.
Amen.
We are not a nation built on religion. We are a nation established on the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's Thomas Jefferson's words. The gospel of Jesus Christ. Benjamin Franklin said that a virtuous people are not easily overthrown. But a people that are not established on morality and virtue, in other words, the principles found in the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Judeo-Christian ethic, a people that are not established on morality and faith are easily destroyed. We are not a virtuous nation anymore. We're not a moral nation anymore. We are not a Christ-centered nation anymore. And the temptation is to be bitter and to be angry and to point fingers at Washington or point fingers at Helena and say, oh, if those crazy bureaucrats, if those crazy politicians would just get right, things would change. Where we should be pointing the finger is at the church. If the church was submitted to the Lord the way these men were, we would have never gotten this far to begin with.
Yeah.
And the only hope for the United States of America